Welcome to our Easter morning service. And isn't it wonderful to have sunshine, even though the sun's so bright I can't see who's in which block here. It's quite tricky. It is a happy, happy day. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let's begin by singing hymn 298 in Singing the Faith. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Come to God in prayer. Let's pray. Lord God of life and power, we rejoice as once more we recognize that you are not bound by death, but that you are alive and with us now as you were with your disciples in Jerusalem on that first Easter morning. It's as hard for us to comprehend as it was for them. But we know that though we don't understand how, you are as close to us as our own breath, and that you understand our every thought and word. Renewal is all around us in the sights and sounds of spring. We sense the burgeoning of new life in the daffodils and primroses, in the spring songs of blackbirds and thrushes, and in the lengthening daylight hours. We thank you for all this new life, but especially we thank you for the new life you promise us because of your resurrection. Help us to treasure it as we should, and to use your gift of life to bring about your kingdom here on earth. Accept our service of praise and thanksgiving, we pray, through the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory for ever and ever. Amen. And now we're going to sing one of the most, I think, the hymns that signifies the resurrection most, because it goes from deep grief to great joy. It's 305 in Singing the Faith, if you're using the book. Low in the grave he lay, Jesus our Savior. Think that is a wonderful hymn. It just epitomizes the whole of what Easter morning is about. And now Michael is going to read our gospel reading, which is from St. John's Gospel, chapter 20, verses 1 to 18. Thanks, Michael.
Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who'd reached the tomb first, also went in. He saw and believed. He still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. And he asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned towards him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I'm ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her.
Amen. Thank you, Michael. We're going to sing another hymn now. It's a morning for singing. It's 309 and Singing the Faith. See what a morning, gloriously bright.
See what a morning. Please.
It's a wonderful hymn. It brings all the joy of Easter to us. And I think the reading that we had this morning, which I chose, I didn't look at the lectionary, I chose this one because it's my favourite Easter reading. I always love it. I feel that it is a wonderful story because it begins with everything dark and gloomy. Jesus is dead. The end of all the hopes and plans for his disciples. Peter and the other disciple go to the tomb and turn away in despair, not even asking what has become of his body. But Mary is distraught. She longs to perform the last services for her Lord, to wash his body, to anoint it with the special oils that were required by Jewish law. In fact, to complete her service to him. And she turns to the man whom she assumes to be the gardener and pleads with him to tell her where to look. If you take him, tell me. And suddenly, as he speaks to her, everything is different. The voice she hears is no gardener. It's Jesus himself. I would like you to try to imagine what Mary felt in that moment. It's such a moment in time. Joy, yes, of course, but surely incredulity as well. After all, she'd seen him die in agony over a horrendously long period. She'd helped to take his body down from the cross. She'd witnessed the hurried burial in Joseph of Arimathea's tomb so as not to break the law about the Sabbath. She knew he was dead. And yet, here he was speaking to her as though nothing out of the way had happened. Mary, just like that. I can't even begin to imagine how she felt at that moment. The impulse to clutch at Jesus must have been very nearly irresistible. But she obeys, not only in this, but also when he tells her to go and tell the other disciples, and she rushes off to do and tell what she's experienced. I do find myself wondering, I suppose as a 21st century woman, how her news was received. Did Peter and the others instantly accept what Mary said and rejoice with her? Or did they treat her as a hysterical woman driven mad by what she'd been through? It would be understandable. I hope they accepted her story quickly, though considering the role of women in Palestine at that time, I do find it a little unlikely. But then, the whole thing seems a bit unlikely, doesn't it? On a purely practical level. A man is nailed to a cross, and hangs there through the heat of the day in Palestine for hours, and then has a spear thrust into his side. His body lies in a cave for 12 hours, vanishes, and then appears back to normal. The only thing you can say really is that you couldn't make it up. But it happened. And I think that Mary was probably the very first of those we call Easter people. She saw and she believed. What I think we have to ask ourselves this morning is this: are we Easter people? if we are, our lives, whatever our problems, should be full of joy. "I've seen the Lord," exclaimed Mary Magdalene. And you can hardly imagine what joy and excitement were in her voice. Are our voices full of joy and excitement when we speak of our faith? Or are they quiet and holy because we want to people to realize how seriously we take our faith? I know which sort of person I'd rather listen to. We must be joyful because Christ is risen from the dead. We must go out with joy and be led forth with praise to win souls for the kingdom. Amen. And we're going to sing that now. 487, "You shall go out with joy and be led forth with praise."
You shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace. And the mountains and the hills shall break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and the trees of the field shall clap.
Joy. And now we come to our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. God of Easter joy, we pray for all those who find it difficult to be joyful, for lonely people, for those who are depressed, for those caught up in conflict, for those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit, and for those who, through no fault of their own, live with hunger and homelessness. Send your people, send us to try to bring the light of your life and joy and love into their hearts, so that they may share our resurrection joy. Help us to live our lives so that we may bring joy to all those with whom we come in contact, however briefly. Sometimes we find it hard to be joyful. We look at the planet which you created for us and for our pleasure. And though around us we see spring flowers and hear birdsong, we know that because of carelessness, because of neglect, and because of greed, every day this wonderful world is losing creatures and plants whose value we underestimate at our peril. give to those in power the vision, we pray, to clean our rivers and seas and to treat our land with love and care, so that our children and our children's children may have reason to be joyful about the world we live in. Merciful Father, I accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We can't end an Easter service without singing 313. Thine be the glory, risen, conquering Son. To spread the joy of Jesus Christ's resurrection and the knowledge of the love of God which surrounds us and surrounds everyone. Let us bring it to all we meet, and let us ask for the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit to be with us and with all whom we love and all whom we ought to love, this day and forevermore. Amen.